Okay, so let's consider a simple example. The simple example that we are going to consider is x plus 2y equal to 1, that is one equation, and x minus y equal to 4, that is the second equation. These two equations in two dimensions represent a line. In case of three dimensions, for example, if we had x plus 2y plus 3z equal to 5, in that particular case that equation would have represented a plane in that particular three dimensional space. So any equation, so for example this particular equation, it is because we have four variables, so this particular equation is going to reside in a four dimensional space, and this will represent a three dimensional surface on, or a three dimensional hypersurface as it is technically called, in a four dimensional space. So what happens is, when we write down an equation of this sort, out of four variables one degree of freedom is lost. Why? Because all these four variables have to satisfy one particular condition. So when one of the degrees of freedoms is lost by writing down an equation of this sort, what this will represent, it will represent a three dimensional hypersurface in a four dimensional space. So we have one equation, x plus 2y equal to 1, that represents this blue line over here, and we have another equation, x minus y equal to 4, and that represents the red line over here. And the point of intersection of these two lines is the point 3 comma minus 1, and that point is the solution of these two equations. So that is the point that satisfies both these equations, okay. Now we can represent these equations in the matrix form, in this particular form. So what we have is, the first coefficient goes of the first equation goes over here, the second coefficient of the first equation goes in row 1 column 2, and so on and so forth. If we had multiple variables, it the first equation, the coefficients will go on the first row of the matrix A, the right hand side will go on the first row of the right hand side of the equation, and that is the vector B, okay. Likewise, we have 1 multiplied by x plus minus 1 multiplied by y equal to 4, okay. So that becomes our second equation. We might have n number of equation in m number of unknowns. If that is the case, we will have n number of rows, that is the number of rows will be equal to the number of equations, and m number of columns, that means the number of columns will be equal to the number of variables, okay. So that is the matrix form of linear equation. And we will talk about the determinant method to solve the linear equations. This method is not used in general for anything beyond say three dimensional equations, and the method again is very popular as Cramer's rule. It is I am quite sure most of us would be aware of the Cramer's rule. What we do is, we define several determinants of the matrix. The original matrix A, that is 1 2 2 minus 1, we will take the determinant of that matrix, and that determinant we will call it as D, and that value of the determinant is minus 1 minus 2, that is equal to minus 3, okay. Then we will construct matrix A1 and A2. A1 is constructed by replacing the first column of this particular matrix A with the vector B, okay. So we replace 1 1 with 1 4, and we will call that matrix as A1, and our matrix A2 is going to be when we replace 2 minus 1 with 1 4, okay. So we will construct matrix AI by replacing the ith column of A with the elements of vector B, okay. We will then take the determinant of A, take the determinant of all the matrices AI, okay. And so in this particular case, the determinant of A we have represented as D, determinant of A1 we have represented as D1, and determinant of A2 we have represented as D2. As you can see, A is 1 1 2 minus 1, A1 is 1 4 2 minus 1, and A2 is 1 1 1 4. In A2 we have replaced 2 minus 1 with 1,4, and in A1 we have replaced 1,1 with 1,4. Okay, and we get these values of determinants, and a unique solution exists if determinant D, that means the determinant of the matrix A, is not equal to 0. If this determinant is equal to 0, then we will either have no solution or we will have infinite number of solutions. Let us take up a couple of examples of no solution. So, the first equation was 1 plus 2y equal to 1. If the second equation is written as 2x plus 4y equal to 4, okay, what this represents is, this represents two parallel lines. Okay, the first line is x plus 2y equal to 1, the second equation is 2x plus 4y equal to 4. Now, because these two lines are parallel to each other, there is no point of intersection, so these two equations do not have any solution. But if we were to write the second equation as 2x plus 4y equal to 2, keep in mind when we write it as 2x plus 4y equal to 2, what we are doing essentially is just multiplying the first equation by 2, and if we were to do that, both these lines will be coincident. Okay. So, if these two lines are going to be coincident, we will have infinite number of solutions. Okay. In both these cases, the matrix A is going to be 1, 2, 2, 4, and if we take the determinant of the matrix A, it is going to be 4 minus 4 equal to 0. So, in either case, if the determinant of the matrix A is equal to 0, we do not have a unique solution. Okay. And if the matrix, if the determinant of matrix A is not equal to 0, then we will have only one solution. Okay. If we do not have a unique solution, we can either have no solution as in this case, or we can have infinite number of solutions as in this particular. And in this particular example, we have x plus 2y equal to 1 as the first equation, and the second equation is 2x plus 3.999y equal to 2.001. Okay. So, if we go back to the previous slide, what I have done is, instead of writing the second equation as 2x plus 4y, I have written the second equation as 2x plus 3.999y. Okay. When we do that, we can see that what that actually means is that the second line is not exactly coincident on this line, or not exactly parallel to this line. It is sloped at a very small angle to this particular line. As a result of this, what happens is that a small changes in any of those numbers associated with matrix A or with the vector B to the right hand side, a very small change in any of those numbers can result in large change in the solution. For example, that first set of equations is x plus 2y and equal to 1 and 2x plus 3.99y equal to 2.001. Okay, and the solution we get is x equal to 3, y equal to minus 1. Okay, but now if the right hand side, instead of being 2.001, if it was just equal to 2, okay, so the equations remain very similar to each other. The only thing that has changed is this particular number has changed from 2.001 to 2, and we see that the solution has changed from x equal to 3 comma minus 1 to x equal to 1 comma 0. So, a very small change in one of these numbers or more than one of these numbers is going to cause a very large change in the solution. Such type of systems are known as ill-conditioned systems or poorly conditioned systems, and whether the system is well conditioned or poorly conditioned is given by the ratio of the highest eigenvalue to the lowest eigenvalue. So, the matrix A in this particular case is 1, 2, 2, 3.999, that is the matrix A. If we take the eigenvalues of this particular matrix, the smallest eigenvalue is minus 2 into 10 to the power minus 4, and the largest eigenvalue is 4.99. The ratio of these two eigenvalues is approximately 25,000. Okay. So, this particular ratio of two eigenvalues is a very large number. As a result of this, what we see is relatively small changes in any of these elements of the matrix of the vector B or any of the elements of the matrix A is going to result in a very large change in the solution. Okay. So, these are typically very difficult problems to solve, And if you are going to use any kind of software in order to solve this problem, for example, if you are going to use MATLAB, then if the ratio of eigenvalues becomes of the order of 10 to the power 9 or 10 to the power 10, you will get an error saying that the matrix is ill-conditioned and the solution may not be accurate. What that really means is that the ratio of the highest and the lowest eigenvalues is very large. As a result, small errors which might creep in because of, in the previous module we had talked about round off errors. So, if errors creep in because of rounding off of numbers, the solutions can be very inaccurate. For example, if this particular number 2.001 was rounded off to 2, we can see that the results would change so drastically. Okay. So, the whereas if this was a well conditioned system, that means if we go up, and in this particular example, if we were to change this particular equation as x plus 2y equal to 1, and if we were to change this equation to x minus y equal to say 4.001, the solution from 3 comma minus 1 would actually change to 2.999 or something like that, and minus 1.001. Okay. So, a fairly small change in this particular equation would cause relatively equally small change in the solution, whereas in this particular in poorly conditioned examples, a small change in any of the numbers of matrix A or vector B are going to cause large changes in the solution x, y. Okay. So, what we are going to do in the next lecture and the lecture so on is not just restrict ourselves to two dimensional or three dimensional systems, but to start thinking about higher dimensional systems and how to represent n equations in n unknowns, when does the system have unique solutions, when do the systems have no solutions, so on and so forth. These are the questions I want you to think about before we move on to the lecture 2 of this module, is when does a system of n equations in n unknowns have a unique solution, when does system of n equation in n unknowns have infinite number of solutions, when does the system of n equations and n unknowns do not have any solution. Okay. This is the way we will write general n by n system of equations, where x 1, x 2, x 3 and x n are n variables, a 1 1, a 1 2 and so on are the n coefficients for the first equation, a 2 1 up to a 2 n are n coefficients of the second equation, and so on up to a n 1, a n 2 up to a n n are n coefficients of the nth equation. Okay. And the next question is, how do we represent this equation in terms of a x equal to b in the standard format? That is the second thing that I want you to think about before we start on to the lecture 2 of this particular module. Okay. And so these are the couple of things that I want you to think about, and we will start off the module by talking about general n by n system of equations. That is what we will do first, then we will solve the previous equation that we talked about, that is x plus 2y equal to 4, 2x plus 3y equal to 7. We will try to solve it with hand and try to understand a few things about how we have solved this equation, and that will motivate us into going to some of the numerical methods to solve these equations. And that numerical method that we will talk about the first is the Gauss elimination method. We briefly talked about Cramer's rule. I will discuss why it is not used in the lecture 2 of this module in the very next lecture. After that, we will talk about Gauss elimination and do some analysis of Gauss elimination. We will talk about Gauss-Jordan. We will use the Gauss-Jordan method for matrix inversion and talk about LU decomposition method. Next, we will talk about special type of matrices known as sparse matrices, and specifically of tridiagonal matrices and algorithm to solve those tridiagonal matrix equations in an efficient manner. All these equations are what are known as direct methods. Then we will talk about what is known as iterative methods, and finally, we will talk about eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So, in the next lecture, I will start off by trying to answer the question, how to do we represent a general n by n system of equations, then I will try to answer the questions about when does the system have unique solutions, infinite solutions, no solution, and then we will start off with the Gauss elimination.